Much of our reporting on climate change has focused on the impact it could have on people or on the environment in which they live. But one area that tends to get less attention is how climate change will affect wildlife. There's a major habitat restoration project in San Francisco Bay that's trying to address that very issue. The NewsHour's Kat Wise has our report.
So welcome, everyone, to our first morning of trapping.
On a recent morning, a small group of volunteers clad in rubber boots gathered in a park on the edge of San Francisco Bay.
So when the animal walks in, he sets the trap off.
They'd come to help U.S. Fish and Wildlife officials gather traps in a restored tidal marsh to determine if an endangered species found only in this area of the bay is making a comeback. Wildlife biologist Rachel Tertis carefully opened the first trap and out spilled a tiny creature, just what they were hoping to find.
This cinnamon belly would tell us pretty much right away that this is a salt marsh harvest mouse.
The endangered harvest salt marsh mouse is, well, pretty cute. It's lost about 90% of its habitat due to human development along the bay. And now, according to Tertis, it faces a new threat, climate change.
The mouse is really tied to this habitat of pickleweed. They live on this plant. They move up and down the plant throughout the tide cycles. One of the concerns with the climate change is really going to be the sea level rise portion of it. So as the tide increases, you have more water covering more plants. And so they have less areas for those for the mice to move up.
While the odds are stacked against it, the harvest salt marsh mouse and several other endangered and threatened species in San Francisco Bay may have a fighting chance, thanks to a large-scale ecological project now underway. It's called the South Bay Salt Pond Restoration Project, and it's the largest tidal wetland restoration effort on the West Coast.
We're at over 15,000 acres, which is an area about the size of Manhattan.
John Bourgeois is the project's executive manager. He's heading up a multi-agency collaboration to turn former industrial salt ponds back into thriving marshland habitat for wildlife and fish. The ponds, which have lined San Francisco Bay's southern shores for more than 100 years, used to be owned by the Cargill Corporation. In 2003, the state, the federal government, and several private foundations acquired them for $100 million and turned them back into public lands. Since then, 3,500 acres, about 25% of the overall project, have been restored.
We're going to show you how much the habitat's come in.
To see the results firsthand, we hopped on a boat with Bourgeois and traveled several miles to one of the first salt ponds that was opened back up to bay waters.
We're entering into what used to be an industrial salt pond. We actually had to cut through this narrow strip of marsh and through this giant levee here. And what used to be in here was a vast salt flat, just white, barren, looked like a moonscape, hard-packed, dense salt. And 8 years later, with these natural processes coming in and allowed to take over, we've got several feet of mud that's actually accumulated, and with this, a new marsh.
The restored marshes have quickly been repopulated with wildlife. Native bird populations have doubled, and fish are thriving. Leopard sharks and other predators have returned, a sign scientists say of a healthy ecosystem. While it may seem like a typical wetlands restoration, open up the levees and let Mother Nature do her thing, this project is actually charting new ground in restoration science. And officials here say with climate change looming in the future, they are taking a very hands-on approach.
As these marshes are accreting sediment and keeping pace with sea level rise, we're also trying to put other enhancements into the landscape.
John Krause of the California Department of Fish and Wildlife showed us one of those new features specially built into the restored areas to help the harvest salt marsh mouse and other wildlife adapt to rising sea levels.
So there's a mound out in the marsh, and what that has is higher ground that's still within the marsh plain and away from the developed edge where there are predators or people, and providing a place for them to seek refuge and have a place to hide when there are high tide events.
In addition, the sides of existing levees are being widened and planted with native grasses. Krause says scientists are closely monitoring how wildlife and fish react to these changes.
Adaptive management is a term of art and science where you're incorporating change in the landscape and watching those changes over time to learn how you might apply that into the future.
Some species of birds actually flourished in the former salt ponds, so project managers have decided some areas will remain as ponds, but with less salinity and newly added nesting grounds. Project manager John Bourgeois.
This pond in particular has been called a Disneyland for birds. We're really trying to maximize the amount of habitat that's available to them in a novel way.
While the focus of the restoration has been to help wildlife, people will also benefit from new recreation opportunities and, most importantly, from increased flood protection. 7 million people live near the edge of San Francisco Bay, which is expected to rise between 16 and 55 inches over the next century. And many Silicon Valley companies, including Facebook and Google, are a stone's throw from the water's edge. Scientists say the restoration of these marshlands, which can dampen storm surges and prevent tidal erosion, may be the best hope some communities have at mitigating the impacts of sea level rise.
We consider ourselves the St. Bernard Parish of New Orleans in the Bay Area.
Charles Taylor is a high-tech worker who lives in a small community called Alviso at the southern end of the bay. The town has sunk about 13 feet over the years due to groundwater depletion. Flooding is a common occurrence. And now Taylor says residents are worried about what might lie ahead with climate change.
Tidal marshlands, of course, are the best prevention for flooding. So yeah, we're definitely hanging our hats on this project.
But while the community is embracing the restoration of the salt ponds, Taylor says some residents feel the effort has been too focused on wildlife. They want project leaders to help them open up 7 acres of slough near the town, which have grown over in recent years.
We'd like to see the Port of Alviso restored. They're concentrating on the wildlife. They're saying it's a wildlife habitat, but it was human habitat prior to that. So at what point do you decide, you know, how far back do you restore?
The project's $1 billion price tag has also been criticized, and some House of Representative Republicans took issue with federal funding to protect the harvest salt marsh mouse during a 2009 stimulus debate.
We'll be paying taxes and interest and debt on this $30 million mouse.
In recent years, the project's been hampered by budget cuts, but Bourgeois says he's doing the best he can for everyone.
The folks that are very wildlife-oriented are concerned that we're providing too much public access. The people that are really concerned about flooding are concerned that we're spending too much time on habitat, and vice versa. So it's all a balancing act, and I figure in my role is if everyone's just a little bit upset with me, I'm probably walking the right line.
The project is expected to take another 30 years to complete. The planning is now underway for a new levee breach, which will bring back bay waters to several hundred acres for the first time in more than a century.
Online, we have an even better view of exactly how much is left of the tidal wetlands in San Francisco Bay. You can find that video at pbs.org/newshour.